This is a new experience for me, putting one of these on. I just put it in my pocket. I guess so. I have to pretend it's not there. I thank God for this time this morning. I really do. I feel the presence of the Lord here this morning. Hallelujah. I'm more and more, I can't hardly, even in my personal time, I can't hardly get 5-10 minutes in front of the Lord. If I can get everything else tuned out, which sometimes takes tremendous concentration. I live in San Diego. We've been there about a year. My family, my wife, and my 7 children. My youngest just turned 3 this week, and my oldest is 12, so they're all about 2 years apart. San Diego is not the cheapest place in the United States to live. And I don't see a lot of people with big families there, to be honest. We meet people wherever we meet people. If we're out by the ocean or in the park, they say, "Now you must be Catholic, or you must be Mormon, or something." And we say, "No." But I'm saying all this, and Dale Pratt, he's got the crown whenever he gets here. But I thank God. God has provided for us. Just in my personal opinion, it's miraculous. And just to hear what Bob said this morning, just everything, I feel just the Spirit of the Lord speaking for himself. I thought this morning in the room, once we really come to know and understand, like what John was saying last night, how God has absolutely apprehended us. Really no doing of our own. It really is the same experience that Paul had on his journey where the brightness of God shined all around him. And he heard the voice. And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" And God began to unveil himself to him in Jesus Christ. And he said, I'm Jesus, who you persecute. The body that you're trying to destroy, that's my body." And we come into this. Paul had a great revelation and understanding of it. He wrote about it there in Romans. You know, we were made subject to vanity, not willingly, but that the glory of God might be seen, and that everything we receive might not be that which we could boast of, but that it might be completely of grace. That our thanksgiving and our praise might be unto the God of all creation. No flesh will glory in my presence, God says. And yet we see Jesus, hallelujah, made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with honor and glory, given a name above every name, because he was obedient, how obedient even unto the death of the cross. Praise the Lord. And he is unveiling himself to us by his mercy and by his grace. And he is absolutely capturing our eye and our vision and our ear, where we want to see him, we want to hear him, we want all the rest of the world that captures our senses and that apprehends us. We want it to be freed to be apprehended completely of Christ, that he might have our full attention. That our ear might be married unto his voice, that we'd hear his voice and obey him and him alone. Because we know that in that is peace, the peace that passes all understanding. When we don't understand in the direction that the Lord is taking us, he has a peace that he wants us to walk in. He wants our joy to be made full, and it's by hearing his voice and knowing him in intimacy. Hallelujah. That I might know him. It becomes the cry of our heart that I might know him. And we want to know him as Paul said, not just in the heights. Hallelujah. Sure, we want to know him in the heights, but that I might know him in the fellowship of his sufferings. Oh, God. See, I think that's what breaks me down. I think that's what, when Bob, the Spirit of the Lord is saying, you don't just rush into the presence of God. There's such a holiness. I find of myself, I'm wretched in my own flesh. I know I didn't choose it. I don't condemn myself, nor do I condemn anybody else. We were birthed into that. No choice of our own. Subject to it. But God's pleasure, little flock, is to give us the kingdom. That we might know those things that have been purchased for us, that have been freely given unto us. That the eyes of our understanding might be enlightened to know that which God has paid the price for and given to us freely as an inheritance. It's the good news of the gospel, hallelujah, that's being twisted, that's being changed, that it's being mixed with something that was past, that God brought a people out of. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I thank God. For me, I rejoice, and I get free in the joy of the Lord, but then I find a real soberness. Something I guess I haven't known so much. I knew it as a young man because I so struggled, like we all do. I struggled so much with my flesh, the things that had captured me as a young man. And I don't condemn myself for it. As was said, everything that we go through, God uses. He uses unto his glory. And we look back and we see God led us. He absolutely took us and directed us in a way that we would not have gone. Praise the Lord. But through it all, our desire is to be as he is. When I think of Peter, and I'm going to go to the scripture, but I think of Peter, and when he first was getting to know the Lord as a fisherman, you know, and when everybody knows the story, or everybody should know the story, when those men were fishing, and Jesus said, go on out. You've been out all night, I know. Just give it one more time. Throw the net over on the other side. And when Peter, I think he was very reluctant. I would have been. You know, we've heard that. Jesus, you're a preacher. Okay, you're a carpenter, if anything. I'm a fisherman. I've been at it all night. But if you say so, we'll give it a try. And when he did, and there was so many fish that it almost sunk the boat, his immediate reaction was to fall down in front of Jesus, to go down on his knees and say, depart from me. I'm a sinful man. Now, I'm amazed at that because Jesus did not condemn Peter. He did not begin to tell. He could have. We know he could have. He knew all things. He had the knowledge. He could grasp it from the memory bank of God, and he could repeat to Peter, this is where you're missing the mark, Peter, here and here and here, and begin to rehearse all of Peter's history to him. But that's not what brought Peter to repentance. It was seeing the glory of God in action, and he obeyed Jesus' voice, and it was more than he could handle. We come to the Lord and we begin to see him work in our lives. And for me, it's more than I can handle. I fall down before him. I say, Lord, I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy of this. And yet he says, but I've chosen you. I've called you, not for your glory, but that you might be a vessel, a channel to bring forth this same life into a people who know me not, who know not of me. Praise God. Hallelujah. These things are so far beyond us, and yet the Lord continually is causing us to grapple with them, to grasp that which he has apprehended us for, to apprehend the understanding that this is his purpose and we will not escape from it. Hallelujah. I'm going to read this out of Isaiah, the 51st chapter. And this is where the Lord has been speaking to my heart. And then I don't get to go to a lot of meetings, but it seems like every time I do, when we're in our personal life, I want to encourage you this morning. I'm in full agreement. There's nothing whatsoever that we can add to the grace of the Lord and to his salvation. But we can yield. We can yield ourselves to God's voice. And when he is working on getting the attention of his people, he knows how to do it. And we can kick against the pricks, or we can do like what was said. We can drop our hands and say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And I've been feeling the Lord moving in my heart. I believe he's moving on an innumerable company to yield ourselves. We don't want to put a doctrine on that, what that means for each individual. But for me, it's meant trying to get everything else out of my mind and come before the Lord and hear him. Hear his voice. Not just in the meetings. The meetings, like what was said, John was going around last night, and I witnessed to this. See, there's a work of the Holy Ghost where he brings everything to remembrance, that which the Lord has spoken. We come together, we gather together, we begin to hear the Spirit of God speak, and he begins to bring to our remembrance the voice of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And our heart rejoices within us. There's a babe within us that leaps. Hallelujah. When we begin to see our Lord in the manifestation of the Word of God, because he is the Word. Hallelujah. He's the living Word, not a doctrine. He's a life that was spoken in the beginning of the world and said, let there be light. And there was light. Hallelujah. And out of our darkness, a light begins to spring forth. There's a birth of life out of darkness, of light, hallelujah. And the darkness comprehended it not. Praise God. The darkness never had power over it. This was the true light that comes into the world to light every man. Hallelujah. And he was in the world, and he created the world, but the world rejected him. But as many as received him, he gave power to become sons of God, to walk in the same nature, in the same life as the firstborn of many brethren. The firstborn, the first begotten of the dead. Hallelujah. Praise God. I feel like the Lord is filling us up with these things. What for? To be a vessel of deliverance. To be a vessel of uplifting. To be a vessel of correction. Of chastisement. What? Against people and their... No, against the wicked one who comes to steal and to kill and to destroy. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I am going to read this. The judgments of God are righteous and holy and pure. I think there's a fear because of the doctrines and the teachings and the traditions. As soon as people, the majority, hear of any judgment of God, they want to run away from God. Get clear of what, you know. But those who know him, it makes us want to draw nearer to him than ever before. Because it isn't unto destruction, but it's unto life, and it's unto freedom. His judgment is to free the prisoner, to release the captive, to heal the brokenhearted, to lift up the cast down. Hallelujah. This is the judgment of the Lord. But on the world, so-called, I don't think God's given us a perfect language yet. I think we've got a lot of the Babylon thing going on. We have a hard time. I think if we're before the Lord, I think about it. If I'm before the Lord, and I'm not just talking about it at these meetings, God help us. If the only time we get really, I think about these meetings, we're in a meeting morning and night, morning and night, morning and night. And I mean to tell you, if you think that you're being raptured, you're leaving your body. If you fully enter into the Spirit of the Lord and heed the Word of God and block everything out and God begins to work in your life, you're going to be lifted. You're going to be lifted.
Yes.
You don't have to try to lift yourself up. You just come into the presence of God and He lifts you up. If that Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwell in you, it shall quicken your mortal body. We're being quickened. But God forbid that we're only quickened in a weekend meeting, or whenever we're gathered together, or whenever, you know, that is the worldly church system, is to come on Sunday and fulfill your quota and then go on with your life and you know, allow God whatever the leftovers are. The Lord's really been dealing with me on that. I know that it isn't just revelation and knowledge that enables us to walk with God. It's not the understanding that we get from learning the rules or learning the revelation, and then we're set. That's not the revelation. The revelation is to be in the presence of Christ Jesus and Him unveil Himself to us continually, continually. And we have to be real careful because, see, we preach anything on this banner and people say, well, you're preaching that we need to spend more time in prayer. You're preaching that we need to do this or do that. And we're putting the law on people. No, this is not the law. This is the new covenant. This is living and dwelling and breathing from the substance of God continually. Continually. The priests, I have to work. I've got 7 children. I go and earn my daily bread right now. But I still nevertheless believe that God has called me and many other to be a part of the priesthood. And the priests, their service was unto the Lord, and their portion was God. That was it. Everything they received as far as their habitation, their food, everything. God said, I'm going to, instead of the firstborn that are mine, all that come out of the womb, the firstborn are mine, God said. They're mine. But He says, I'm going to exchange the Levitical priesthood for my firstborn. So they're going to be mine, just as Samuel was, wholly given unto the service of the Lord. We're not going to put numbers on it, like what was said. We're not talking about trying to keep a track of time or trying to keep a log of how much time we've spent with the Lord. It is an obedience to give Him everything we have, whatever that means for each individual. But I feel the pull stronger and stronger and stronger, personally. I do. Because we've got to hear from the Lord Himself. We have to. We have to. I know that the majority of the church is still dealing under the old priesthood, under the old order, which was, Moses, you go up to God. You go up to the mountain, you speak to God, we'll wait here. And you come and you be the mediator for us. That covenant is gone. Praise the Lord. He said, I'm going to have a nation of kings and priests. And all shall know me. And you'll no longer teach one another, know ye the Lord. All right, I'm going to read this. It says, hearken to me, ye that follow after righteousness, ye that seek the Lord. I take this as a personal word to myself. Hearken to me. Listen to me. Ye that follow after righteousness, ye that look unto the Lord, seek unto the rock whence ye were hewn, and to the hole of the pit whence ye are digged. Look unto Abraham, your father, and unto Sarah that bare you. For I called him alone, and blessed him, and increased him. For the Lord shall comfort Zion. He will comfort all her waste places, and he will make her wilderness like Eden, and her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness shall be found therein, thanksgiving and the voice of melody. Praise God. That's a good news. I looked at the couple different translations, and I never used to do that. I used to kind of make fun of it. Look at the Greek and all those things. I found out, though, I like to do that now a little bit. Because I found out they really did change some words. As much as I love King Jimmy, there's things that got manipulated a little bit. But it said in that number two, look unto Abraham and your father, and unto Sarah that bare you, and it says in pain she delivered you. Isaiah is speaking in riddles, kind of, in mysteries. But God's given us the Spirit that we might know the things that are freely given unto us. And we've been birthed of a new seed, of an incorruptible seed. We've been birthed. Just as Sarah was barren, but it was a promise that Abraham was going to have a son, and that his increase was going to be as the sand of the seashore and as the stars of the sky. And true birth into the kingdom of God, there's travail. There's soul travail. I don't know of anybody that truly has been where they know that they were completely apprehended of Christ and their life is no longer their own. And they live completely for Christ. Completely. They were birthed from the church. The church gave birth. There was a relationship there. So how can one believe except he hear? And how can one hear except there's a preacher? Behold, how beautiful are the feet of them who bring glad tidings. Hallelujah. We receive the word of God not just out of some mysterious glory, though Paul did. But I believe Paul didn't just hear it that first time. He was in the presence of Stephen and others who were stoned to death for their testimony of Christ. This wasn't the first meeting that Paul had with Jesus. He'd seen Jesus in action through the disciples that he was persecuting. So he'd already heard the word. The seed had already entered into Paul's heart, and he was kicking against it. Yeah. I found out I had that same experience. I kicked against that word a lot of my youth. But there was a point where the Lord's will overtook my will. I love to get in conversations with folks about free will. I love it. They say, we have a free will, and we choose whether or not we serve the Lord. And I said, yes, and Jonah had a free will. And God said, go to Nineveh, Jonah, and preach to that great city. And Jonah used his will and said, I will not go. And he got on that ship and went the other direction. And God said, okay, don't go, Jonah, don't go. And we know the story. He was thrown overboard, and he was converted. And his will fell into a line with God's will. And he came back and he said, yes, God, I will go. And he used his free will, and his will met God's will, and he went together. Hallelujah. And he became co-workers together with God. Praise the Lord. We've got 1,000 testimonies of that same life. God has a way far above our ways. Thank God. And he's the only one that can apprehend the heart and change it and transform it and cause it to be turned into something he can write his laws upon. Hallelujah. I've taken out the hard heart and I've given the heart of flesh that I might write my word upon the fleshly tables of your heart, that you might be transformed into a new creation, a new creature. Hallelujah. That you might hear my word and begin to deliver my word unto a people who know me not. Huh? That you might be the light in the midst of a dark place and shine forth my glory. And pay the price for it. Hallelujah. Praise God. No one goes to battle without first counting the cost. The Lord lets us know. Paul, go pray for this man. And show him how many things he's going to suffer for my namesake. That's the most unpopular doctrine that there is in this day. We are going to pick out the Bible and choose what word we like, and that's what we're going to minister. And everything else that we don't like or don't understand, we're going to leave alone. But I've heard the Lord tell me, you're going to read cover to cover my word. You're going to go through each word, and then you're going to go through it again. And you're going to be in the midst of a people who do not reject my word based on what their flesh desires, but who want my word regardless of what it brings to their flesh. And their flesh may war against it, as Jesus did in the garden. Father, if this cup shall pass, let it pass, but nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. Who in the days of his flesh cried out with strong tears unto him who was able to save him. Hallelujah. And if the master was called Beelzebub, if the master of the house was cast out, how much more the disciples? Praise the Lord. So, as has been said, God's had it over in a corner. He's had it over somewhere where there wouldn't be too much persecution. But we're coming to the day, praise God, where God's given us wisdom. His wisdom. Hallelujah. God is building this house. Hallelujah. By wisdom. Praise God. I'm going to keep reading this. Hearken unto me, my people. And give ear unto me, O my nation, for a law shall proceed from me, and I will make my judgment to rest for a light of the people. My righteousness is near, my salvation is gone forth, and my arms shall judge the people. The isles shall wait upon me, and on mine arm shall they trust. Hallelujah. Out to the islands. I heard that word last night. God's gathering a remnant people unto himself. He's gathering those, and I battled with this as a young man as well. See, I heard a lot of what is being preached, and God has added to it since I was a child. Nearly 40 years ago, you know, I was very young, and I heard the message of the kingdom of God and these things all the way up from my youth. And when I got to the point where I began to understand what was being said, there were certain things that I really struggled with. And to be honest with, maybe I still do struggle with them. A first fruit company. a people chosen unto God for this day and for this hour. Maybe the reason why I struggled with it is for exactly the reason that was said, because a lot of what men have written about and what has been preached, which was pure spirit, divine life, it wasn't in a way that somebody could write it down and teach it in necessarily a seminary. But that's how it immediately became. It was brought down into the understanding of a man so that they could glory in it. And when that exchange takes place, there's a defilement of the Word of God. And it's used no longer to bring people out of the darkness, but it's used to keep people in a place where they can be ruled over. But praise God, God's dealings are getting rid of that. God's dealings are taking that and consuming it by the very fire of His presence as He comes into the midst, individually or corporately, as an individual or as a church body or as a fellowship. The Lord is, hallelujah, allowing the works of God to take place, which people would call the works of the devil. I created the waster to destroy. All things are in His power. The enemy can't do anything to Job except he comes before God and says, "Do I have permission, God?" "Yes, you have permission, but this is as far as you're allowed to go." Hallelujah. These things people want nothing to do with. Why would they? My flesh doesn't either. If it came down to that, yes, Lord, take me out of here as quick as possible. And take me to the streets of gold, to glory. Woo! And I looked down, I heard a preacher say, we'll be having the supper of the Lamb, and we're going to throw our chicken bones down on those poor sinners in earth. It'll be a chicken dinner. Goodness sakes. Whoa. I thank God I didn't hear a lot of that as a youth. The things that I rejected mainly were the things my flesh warred against. Josh, they're not going to all just receive you. You begin to tell your friends, even Christian friends, especially Christian friends, what you hear, and they're going to reject you. That's tough in a world where you grow up as a young man and you're seeking popularity. That's kind of the goal a lot of times in school age. The more friends, the better. Good grief, man. It doesn't work out so well. I wonder if some of the preachers have ever gotten out of grade school. It's still all about popularity. I'm sorry. That was not Jesus's way. Yes, He knew how to draw the crowds, and He did it supernaturally. But He knew how to thin them out just as quick. And when He began to say, "You want to come unto me? You need to eat my flesh and drink my blood." There was a bunch that left Him immediately. "This man, how can you give us your flesh to eat and your blood to drink?" But when they got down to just a few, the Lord began to reveal it. He said, "Are you two going to leave me?" They said, "No. You have the words of life." He says, "I'm telling you the truth. The flesh profits nothing, but the word that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The great mystery that God can glorify a human being. Ha ha! Jesus was flesh and blood just as we are. And yet He carried the full glory of God. It indwelled Him bodily as a man. It no longer indwells Jesus just singularly as a man, but He says, "Now ye are the body of Christ. Ye are the temple of the living God." Not singular, but plurally. As a many-membered body. And when we stand together, the glory of God shines. So God is sending out the word. As I've heard now for several years, the trumpet of God is blowing. And those who hear the voice of the Lord are beginning to stand to attention. It doesn't mean that there isn't times and seasons and times of falling back and all these kind of things. Sure, there are growing pains. But overall, if we were, I watch the real or the market, the financial market. That thing is crazy, man. You can watch it just if you watch the graph of it in one day, like the Dow Jones Industrial. Goodness sakes, man. And it does that every single day. But if you step back a month, you see more accurately what's going on. If you step back a year, even more so. The huge curves that were going on day by day are now becoming a plane that's going up or going down. And you look at it in 10 years, and now you see even more. You can go clear back to the 1920s and see what it's done. And now it's more of a, but even with the great falls, it's been a continual rising. Now, I'm not trying to predict what the Dow Jones is going to do. But we're our life is not, if it was just that neat, and we just said from the day that I came to know the Lord, it's just been an upward climb. Praise God. Well, it has. But in the midst of that upward climb, there's been days where I fell down to the deepest hell, like what was ministered last night. I hear people going through things now, and they say, I don't know if I'm going to hold my salvation through this. I hear people say it that are very close to me, very close. They wouldn't go around preaching that. They're telling me really where their heart is. And these are people that have walked, some of my very close family. My dad's been going through hard things in his body, in his mind, hard. If you don't, I don't have to even ask you if you don't think that shakes you up. Everybody's going through things, and it shakes your world. But thank God, see, for me, I more and more, I see the end result. He who sees the end from the beginning. We fix our eyes, as Jesus did, on the end of the situation. I'm going to go through all these things. You're going to leave me. But in the end, you're going to know. This was a purpose. If I didn't go through it, it remained one. But if I go through it, there's going to be such a multiplication, it couldn't be expressed numerically. There's no way. We can't express it. Not with that which is both seen and that which is unseen. How can we express it? Hallelujah. And it didn't just include those from the time of Jesus. It included all those from the day of Noah, where Jesus went into the prison houses and preached unto those. Hallelujah. They used to say, you're going to blow hell wide open or something like that. And they were talking about going into hell. Well, we're reversing the doctrine. Hell's going to be blown wide open, all right, because every soul is coming up out of it. Hallelujah. Praise God. This is the truth. People have suffered on account of the truth. Bless them, Lord. Keep them in the midst of that. Let them not go astray from the vision that you've given them, because it needs to be revealed. We don't want to put off the day. We want to enter into it. Hallelujah. And tell people the truth in love. All are his. All are mine, says the Lord. Hallelujah. Forgive me, I'm getting all caught up, and I'm gonna read a little bit more of this here. My righteousness is near. This is the fifth verse. My salvation has gone forth, and mine arm shall judge the people. The isles shall wait upon me, and on mine arm shall they trust. Lift up your eyes to the heavens, and look upon the earth beneath. For the heavens shall vanish away like smoke, and the earth shall wax old like a garment. And they that dwell therein shall die in like manner, but my salvation shall be forever, and my righteousness shall not be abolished. Hallelujah. This is quoted then again by Paul and by Peter. The heavens will be set on fire. There's John in Revelations, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth wherein dwelt righteousness. I'm going to go to Corinthians real quick. The third chapter, Paul's talking about the increase of this. I contemplated that recently because I hear the statistics that are going on in the church. Can I switch this out? I'm going to. My head's starting. I'm stationary. Is this on?
Okay.
When I look at they give all the statistics, you know, you hear good report and bad report concerning the growth or the faltering of the church, and they're talking about those who, I don't know how they do these surveys, but who the Christians that are in America, whether that's increasing or decreasing, you know, more people going to church, less people going to church. A lot of people are very concerned because it seems there's less of the generations that are coming up that call themselves Christians, and much more atheism in this country, people that say they don't believe in God. But we don't view it that way, not whatsoever, because we're not basing what we believe or our hope on statistics or on what's going on around us. Our confidence is in the rock. He's an offense, the rock of stumbling, but he's a cornerstone, a chief cornerstone. And when everything else that can be shaken is shaken, there's a foundation that we stand on that is not shaken. And the word of God says that his kingdom is always on the increase, always increasing. Praise God. So we're not judging this after the flesh. And that's where I go back to, and I'm going to read this, but Paul talking about the increase and the laborers. He says in the ninth verse, 1 Corinthians 3:9, for we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. We are God's building. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he build thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now if any man build upon this foundation gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest. For the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. And the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. And I think our eyes have got to be fixed on the eternal things of God. My children are very young. And yet I right now, what we've been doing in San Diego, We've just been having home services. Sometimes it's just me and my family, to be honest. I tell you, we still gather together. We worship the Lord. We wait on God. I'll spend and we'll pray, and the presence of God will begin to come. And I see my children begin to weep before the Lord. Because at the same time, we're doctrine. You know, we do teach teaching. We do teach. We want our children to know the truth. The truth will make them free. But we want them to know the truth not as an intellectual understanding. We want them to know the truth experientially. We want them to know it by the experience of the touch of God upon their heart. It transforms from the inside out. God doesn't deal first with the outer. He deals with the inward, as what is said. And that what is said, death is swallowed up in victory. I love that. I got a picture of it last night when it was ministered. See, those things are the reality that we want our children that are coming up in this perverse and crooked generation to understand. This heaven, this earth that people are counting on, it's passing away. It will not remain. I know that I know the doctrine. I know that it passed away when Jesus, I know that age passed away. Praise God. The old covenant passed away. That understanding that Israel had, it passed away. There was a new heaven. There was a new earth. There was a new covenant. There was a great noise. The veil was rent in twain. Praise God. It became a house of defilement, that old covenant. It became a Babylonian system. Yes. Praise God. But God doesn't, the revelation of God, quit holding it in a box, as has been said. Men get understandings of doctrine and they hold on to that with all their might and they refuse to receive anything else from God. Well, my great-grandfather, Westlake, used to say, they'll just go around that mountain. They drove their stakes and that's where they'll stay. But he said, I'm going on with God. I know my grandfather, everybody I know said they'd come into that church. He had a little parsonage in the bottom of that church, and he was on his face, laying prostrate before the Lord. He'd break down and weep in the presence of God by himself. He wanted to hear from God. He was real willing to release his own doctrines and understanding that he might receive a fresh revelation from the Lord. That it might prosper him? Yes. That he might benefit? Yes. That he might suffer because people would reject it? Yes. We know it to be true. Yes. The human condition is very comfortable with tradition. Yes. Very comfortable with tradition. Yes. Ingrained in us. Digging our heels in. Yes. Hard-necked. My mother used to tell me, you either fall on the rock and be broken, or the rock falls on you and crushes you into powder. He'll remake you one way or the other. Jesus said, no man takes my life from me, I lay it down. I'd rather lay it down. I'd rather hear the voice of God and that be my judgment. His voice unto me is my judgment. His word has judged me. Hallelujah! I hear the voice of God and I fall to pieces. And if I don't, Lord, help me. I want to be broken before the Lord. I want to be pliable in his hands. God, help us as a church. Help us as a people. Not be stiff-necked and hard-hearted. Hallelujah! We can easily see it in our brother. It's harder when the Lord brings it right to our doorstep. David said, I'm going to kill that man. That man needs to die who did that thing. He didn't know it was him. Took that little lamb, the only lamb that man had. Oh my God. Hallelujah. The Lord is waking us up. There's the things that our heart is attached to, we better be very careful what we're attached to. Because if it's attached to that which is passing, we're going to suffer loss. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And to be honest, suffering's going to come one way or the other. It'll either be for wrongdoing or it'll be for righteousness' sake. But blessed is the man who suffers for righteousness' sake. Hallelujah. I found out as a young man, there's a glory to that. There's not much glory when I keep hitting my head against a wall trying to go my own way and God's trying to turn me. There's not much glory in that. In the end, there is. So if we see it from the end picture, even that God uses. Thank God. But the Lord is looking for us for an obedient people that are gentle. The fruits of the Spirit. Gentleness, meekness, self-controlled. Hallelujah. Against such these, there's no law against these things. I thank God for what he's doing. I know that the Lord is doing such a work in this day, there's no singular man that can express it. There's just no way. There might have been a time when people flocked to just one individual because God had so, and see that Moses, that day, it's just been fading. I know it was done away with at the cross. It was done. As far as Jesus was concerned, it was done. But look at us, 2,000 years later, and people are still holding on to that. But it's passing. Hallelujah. It's like the flower that fades, like the grass that grows up, and then as soon as the sun begins to appear, it just withers and fades away. Praise God. God takes away the first that he might establish the second. Praise the Lord. And there's an establishment. As that other thing is fading away, there's an establishment of a kingdom that shall not be moved. Hallelujah. And that kingdom is right now in the midst of your heart. Praise God. The word is nigh thee, even in thy heart, even in thy mouth. Not that you have to say who will go up into the heaven to bring Christ down or who will go down into the deep to bring him up from the dead, but it's nigh you. Hallelujah. The word which we speak, the living word. Praise the Lord. Seek the face of God. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your things acknowledge him, and he shall direct your steps. Hallelujah. He wants you to be in joy that you might know him in every way. Oh my God. He loves us with such a love. Greater love has no man than this, that he laid down his life for his friend. And I'm telling you what, he laid it all down. Now glorify thou me with the glory that I had before the Father, before the world was. Hallelujah. Yes. The glory that he laid down was going to be exchanged for a greater glory. That's how it is with us. The glory that the Lord has been, it was like Moses' face when he came down from the mountain. He had to put a veil over his face. And I'm amazed. It says he put a veil over his face so that they might not see the fading of that glory. That it was a passing order. Praise God. But there's a new glory. There's a newness. Look not to the former days. Praise God. We forget those things that are behind, but we press on. It's moving more rapidly all the time. People say, well, this is brand new. Well, it might already be waxing old. That's the truth. Not that we're looking for new doctrines. I'm not looking for a doctrine. I'm looking for the doctrine. I'm looking for Jesus Christ himself, and he'll bring the doctrine. Praise God. I know that forgive me for the language, John. I know I don't, doctrine and dogma, and I know it to be true. I know. Brother Stacy Woods, he taught it when I was young, and I heard him. Wonderful. Such ability to use the English language to get across a point that, you'd say, thank God, I know that's the truth. Hallelujah. But the Lord's gonna this Babylonian thing is being done away with. Their languages were confused. They fought. I think the wars and the strife that came out of that was based all on an inability to really communicate. The Lord's given us a holy language, a pure language. It's the Spirit of God. He baptized us in the Holy Ghost that we would speak not our words, but His words. Praise the Lord. I love you.